In Philadelphia, this new police recruit is getting a taste of confronting a suspect that he may have to shoot. This training in full protective gear is known as a reality-based scenario. This is a lesson in defusing high-tension encounters before they turn deadly. In Philadelphia, every officer gets 40 hours of this reality training to learn tactics other than lethal force, even when suspects are armed and dangerous.
Is he threatening anybody right now?
No.
Is he killing anybody right now?
No.
So do we have to turn around and jump right in there and take care of it ourselves?
No.
Sergeant Kenneth Gill, a police academy instructor, says the training is designed to teach police officers how to de-escalate emotionally charged confrontations.
Don't leave your partner. Do not leave your partner.
Slow down the momentum. Don't just always just rush into something. You want to be able to look at your surroundings. What else can I do except for jump in?
With so many questionable police shootings caught on camera during the past 2 years, how police are trained is coming under greater scrutiny, along with calls for reform. Studies by the Washington Post and The Guardian found police in this country shot and killed about 1,000 people last year, almost 3 people a day. The Post found 987 cases, and The Guardian, 1,014. The country's 18,000 police departments, on average, train officers for only a total of 15 weeks before rookies hit the streets. Maria Haberfeld, a professor of police science at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice in New York, blames poor police training, not rogue cops, for many questionable cases of lethal force.
There are police officers who do not belong on the job who are trigger happy, but this is not the overwhelming majority. To the contrary, this is a fraction of a fraction. But the overwhelming majority are poorly trained.
For police departments around the country, guidelines on the use of lethal force are based on Supreme Court rulings that justify it when officers feel that they or others are in imminent danger. But there are no national standards. And in the wake of so many notorious police shootings, some departments, like the one here in Columbus, are reinforcing the idea that deadly force should be a matter of last resort.
So he has a knife.
At the police academy here, veterans and rookies alike are studying videos of police-involved shootings.
What else could have been done? Could this life have been saved? How would you do it yourself? Is there a better way?
Police Chief Kim Jacobs, a 36-year veteran of the Columbus Police Department, became chief in 2012. After the 2014 Ferguson, Missouri police shooting of Michael Brown, who was unarmed, Jacobs ordered new lethal force training in Columbus. Community meetings had convinced her that a change was needed.
Why do people fear us? I mean, I heard that in our community meetings. People fear the police. That's absurd to me because we're the good people, and yet people are afraid of how we're going to react.
And that is understandable, Chief Jacobs says, when people see videos like this 2014 recording of a police dashboard camera in South Carolina. The incident began when State Trooper Sean Grubert pulled over driver LeVar Jones for not wearing a seatbelt. Grubert asked Jones for his driver's license.
Has he your license, please?
When Jones reached inside his car, Grubert opened fire.
Did that seem like a threat to you?
I had no reason to think that there was a threat at that point in time. When I think about when I would justify myself pulling the trigger, I want to be certain that I am in imminent danger. And there's some way that that could happen.
Jones survived. Grubert was fired and charged with aggravated assault.
What could the cop do differently?
In Columbus, such videos are case studies in how not to handle potentially combustible moments. Chief Jacob says a rush to use of lethal force is a common mistake and one that contributed to one of Ohio's most infamous police shootings, the death of 12-year-old Tamir Rice in Cleveland in 2014. Rice had been holding a toy gun in a park when police responding to a 911 call drove within a few feet of Rice and seconds later opened fire.
What alternative did those officers have? What could they have done better?
Not gotten that close. They could either get out on foot and approach him and, you know, given him orders, let me see your hands, all that kind of thing. They could have tried to find out either via intercom or something else what this person's intentions were.
In Philadelphia, a spike in police shootings 3 years ago led then Police Commissioner Charles Ramsey, who retired earlier this month, to ask the U.S. Justice Department for help.
I wanted to take a look at our training. I wanted to look at our policy to make sure we're doing everything we can to minimize the number of times that an officer would actually have to resort to the use of deadly force.
Turn around slowly. Keep those hands up.
The Justice Department offered more than 90 recommendations, including increased reality-based training, which emphasizes strategies that give police more time and distance from suspects in high-risk encounters.
All right. You have to call for backup right away.
Such tactics include calling for backup, finding cover or moving away from a dangerous suspect, engaging the suspect in conversation.
Slow the momentum. Remember that word? Slow it down.
Since adopting the recommendations, the Philadelphia Police Department's fatal shootings are down. In 2013, police shot and killed 11 people. That fell to 4 in 2014 and only 2 last year.
We have to train to make sure that our officers only use the force necessary under the most extreme circumstances, that being deadly force, period. Doesn't matter who the offender is.
But training in deadly force tactics is strictly up to individual police departments. Maria Haberfeld argues that needs to change.
To me, it's mandatory to identify minimal standards for each and every police department in the country with regard to use of force, and not just the length of training, but also the content. Because it's one thing to train police officers how to use a gun, but it's another to train police officers what kind of factors go into using deadly force.
Haberfeld and other criminologists say police departments also need to incorporate more training on race. In Columbus, black people make up 28% of the city's population, but only 12% of the police force. Sergeant James Fuqua says having more officers who reflect the neighborhoods they patrol could help reduce misperceptions and violent exchanges.
I'm not calling anybody a racist or it's racially motivated. I just think sometimes there's a misunderstanding with cultural differences.
Did you get hassled because you were a young black man?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Just because of the color of my skin and the neighborhood in which I lived many of times, I was, for lack of better words, harassed. When I got older, I realized that they weren't bad people and they were just doing their job. And then once I became an officer, I realized that, you know, they were trying to do their job. But at the end of the day, they kind of did a poor job with the community policing aspect of it.
Former federal prosecutor Sharon Davies believes police training should also focus on unintended or implicit racial bias. Davis heads the Kerwin Institute on Race at Ohio State University and is a consultant to the Columbus Police.
If those associations are negative, such as presumptions of violence or threat or criminality, that can make a police officer see a threat where there is no threat.
What do you see as potential solutions? I mean, do we need changes in state law, or do we need much better police training?
There's absolutely no question that all police forces should be trained about the reality of unconscious racial biases that affect all of us. That's a reality that all of us need to take very seriously. And police officers especially.
Not even the most advanced training can eliminate lethal force, and police are legally justified to use it in order to save lives, including their own. In fact, The Washington Post study found that in 3/4 of the fatal shootings, police were under attack or defending someone who was. In Philadelphia and Columbus, police are convinced better training can give officers better options than shooting to kill.
You don't grow up being taught how to deal with the police. The police are taught how to deal with our citizens. And so it's our responsibility